Another case solved. Another late night at the office. There I was, contemplating, with my favorite drink, milk on the rocks, and a single chocolate-covered Oreo. It was a day like any other day, except it wasn't. And it began right here, when I heard footsteps. Come in. What can I do for you?
I heard you were the man to look for when it comes to Read-Aloud.
Maybe I am, maybe I'm not. She had hair as black as night and the voice of an angel. I knew she was trouble from the moment I saw her. But then again, trouble is my middle name.
Here, see what you could do with this.
I'll give it a shot.
And by the way, detective, thank you for the cookie.
I knew she was trouble. Man, I really wanted that cookie. Welcome back, Wisin Girls, and welcome back to another edition of Read Aloud with Mr. Morales. And for today, we have one of my favorite books, Tough Cookie. And the reason why I love Tough Cookie is because it was written in the style of something known as the Detective Noirs. And Detective Noirs was a style of books. It began as books in the 1940s, but then it got made into TV shows and movies. And they all kind of had this similar feel to it. They were usually black and white, and they had like this jazz music in the background, and it was kind of dark and again, mysterious. And they were really fun to watch, really fun books to read. So
this is paying homage to that type of style.
And we're going to go along with it. So now that I spoke about this, here's something you probably don't know. Is that type of books and films, Detective Noirs, is something that we actually still see a lot of in the media. A lot of people do parodies, whether they're making fun of it or they're playing homage to it. Either way, you probably see it a lot more than you think. You just don't realize that's what you're looking at.
So first, let me give you an example of what it looks like in film. So we're going to roll the clip and see what it looks like in film.
The windows were closed and the sunshine coming in through the Venetian blind showed up the dust in the air. On the piano in a couple of fancy frames were Mr. Dietrichson and Lola, his daughter by his first wife. They had a bowl of those little red goldfish on the table behind the big Davenport. But to tell you the truth, Keys, I wasn't a whole lot interested in goldfish right then. Or in auto renewals or in Mr. Dietrichson and his daughter, Lola. I was thinking about that dame upstairs and the way she had looked at me. And I wanted to see her again, close. Without that silly staircase between us.
Long, was I?
Not at all, Mrs. Dietrichson.
Hope I've got my face on straight.
It's perfect for my money.
Okay, so you kind of get that vibe of the narration, the black and white. But the thing is, like, again, you see it, you've seen it in some of your favorite cartoons or maybe like TV shows. You just weren't aware. So now I'm going to give you a couple of examples of times where you've seen Detective Noirs in today's media. So here we go. It begins right now.
Hey, fellas. Wherever I go, the wind follows. And the wind, it smells like rain. My name is Peter Parker.
I was bitten by a radioactive pig.
It's 1933, and I'm a private eye. I like to drink egg creams, and I like to fight Nazis. A lot. Sometimes I let matches burn down to my fingertips just to feel something, anything. Oh.
Is that all you got? You're gonna body you just bumping gum, you hard-boiled turtle slapper.
Aw, did that feel like a cartoon?
I love you all. I'm taking this cube thing with me. I don't understand it, but I will.
Like no one understands.
The street lamp's burning bright enough to be tag-teaming with the sun to keep the world illuminated. The clock tells me that it's 1:15 midnight. I've been sitting at this desk since 8 in the morning. but any detective worth his salt knows that these are the prime hours of the day. Footsteps coming from outside my office. They don't sound like they're in a hurry, but someone paying me a visit at this hour definitely isn't coming all the way up here for a friendly hello. What can I do for you?
I've got a little situation on my hands, and I need a man with an eye for detail to help me out. I took one look at him and knew he was the man for the job. There was something about the way he occupied Shadow so comfortably, like it were a natural habitat.
I could almost feel her eyes sizing me up, studying every nook and cranny that she could find, each one with its own story to tell.
You're ready, my dear. We've got the... That's how it began. My life smashed to bits. My living room covered in broken dreams. Without my clarinet, the world was a drab and colorless place. And that's when I saw him, my first suspect. When it came to paying the stupid bill, SpongeBob always tipped 20%. He had to be involved.
SpongeBob, what have you done with my clarinet?
Ooh, Squidward, you're so hard-boiled. Are you playing a game? Can I play?
I know you stole my clarinet. Tell me.
It couldn't have been me, Squidward. I have an alibi. I was at Grandma's house all day, and I have the kissy marks to prove it. See? There's room for one more.
His alibi was solid. Only a family member could stomach putting their lips on this fool.
You know, we have lots of friends. Maybe they could help us find your clarinet.
I don't have friends. I have suspects.
Oh, Squidward, don't you know a suspect is just a friend you haven't cleared of charges yet? So, can I help you solve your case? Please, please, please!
Try not to get in the way.
Yeah! It's a play date! All right, I'll partner up with you this time.
My partner and I decided to check out my next suspect, the owner of a local greasy spoon. I figured a little good cop, bad cop would get his jaw flapping, so I...
No! Well, can I be the bad cop? Please, please, can I please?
Yes, if you get out of my hard-boiled narration.
Sorry.
So as you can see, boys and girls, we are still being inspired by Detective Noir, right? With the type of films and the type of books, as we saw right now, those examples. So for today, we are going to be reading Tough Cookie, and we're going to do the same style of reading as in the original books. So once again, I hope you enjoy this read aloud. And when you're done reading this book with me, I want you to hit the link below because we have a cool our project that kind of relates a little bit to this book. And I'm sure you'll have a lot of fun with it. It's a wacky project, a simple project. But either way, boys and girls, I need you right now to put on your detective private eye hats on. I need you to get ready and enjoy this read aloud because it begins right now.
Tough Cookie. The Jar Transit Authority welcomes you to the Jar and hopes that the following information makes your stay safer and more enjoyable. Please remember to carry your ID card and sell by date with you at all times. Freshness determines your level within the Jar. It's the law. When your sell by date expires, please report to the nearest processing center for clearance to the next level down. Those assigned to the bottom of the Jar no longer need report to a processing center. Crumbs will not be issued ID cards and must remain at the bottom of the Jar. The lid. As there may be a sudden movement at any time, please avoid this area after your initial entry. Skynet and processing center. After a cushion fall, a new arrivals are assigned living space based on freshness and quality. Up Jar. This exclusive neighborhood is home to just baked and best quality store-bought citizens. Crocker Observatory. This state-of-the-art facility monitors lid movement. Mid-jaw. This level is the site of major business, cultural, and government centers. The Alps. These elevators connect mid-jaw to up-jaw. Down-jaw. Most shops, service, schools, and apartment buildings are located here. Pillsbury Expressway. This excellent highway system also features convenient bus service. The bottom of the jar. Visitors to this area should travel in groups. They call me a tough cookie. I guess I am. Came from a regular batch. Lots of dough. Lived the high life. Top of the jar. Then I hit bottom. Stayed here. It was rough. Still is. But you get used to it. Life's still sweet. Just a little stale. The bottom's loaded with nice folks. Some call them crumbs. I call them friends. I like helping them out. Anybody makes trouble, I step in. That's my job. I'm a tough cookie. I'm knocking back a cup of Java when this classy blonde rolls up. Store-bought, easy on the eyes. Peeking Sandy, I say, long time. Better that way, she says. We used to be an item. Didn't work, still hurts. So what's up, I mutter. She chokes back, a sob. Your partner. My raisins turn to ice. Chips? She's crying now. Fingers got him. I grab her arm. Where? Cross jaw, she says, getting a grip. This cookie don't crumble. Cap's outside. Chips and I go way back. Enter the jar at the same time. Joined the force together. Became partners. We were good. Busted the ginger snaps. Broke up the macaroons. But then, they loaded him when we get there. He's chewed up pretty bad. I take his hand. Chips, I say. He opened his eyes. Gasped. Fingers. Looking for you. Shock jolts my gut. But I don't let it show. Fingers don't come this far down. Did this time, groans Chip. I squeeze his hand. You're a tough cookie. You'll make it. He closes his eyes. Yeah, he mumbles. I'll make it. They take him away. Standing in the cold night, a hot flood of memory hijacks my brain. Mom, Dad, the top of the jar, the knock of the door, fingers. And later, me and Chips, the Pfeffernesser case, tried to save them, couldn't. Fingers, fingers! A slap stings my cheek like a velvet bee. Snap out of it, pipes Peeking Sandy. You can't run anymore. You're such a tough cookie. Prove it. You're right, I say. Time to put fingers away for keeps. At the police station, the chief offers nothing but lousy coffee and bad advice. Forget about it, son, he says. You can't stop fingers. Other cops gather around. They look big. They talk tough, but inside, they're marshmallows. That's right, they mumble. Nobody stops fingers. We'll see about that, I say. Crumbs are waiting outside. Word travels fast. We owe you big time, says one. Let us help. The others nod. Their faces blur. It gets hard to talk. I look away. Thanks, I say, but no thanks. This is between fingers and me. It's a long ride to the top of the jar. I begin to think, maybe I'm a nut bar to do this. Then I think of chips. The door's open. Everything's fresh and warm. I grab the first guy I see. Hey, gumdrop, I say. Where's fingers? The guy can't take the pressure. Starts to snap. I don't know, he squeals. That's when trouble starts. The jar shakes. The sky opens. Fingers! Gumdrop's the first to go. A couple of shortbreads get a dex. Then fingers heads towards yours truly. Darkness covers me like a damp sponge. Can't move. Can't breathe. It's the end. Then the doors open. Pecan Sandy strides in, followed by every crumb in the jar. They lay on fingers by the hundreds, the thousands. Fingers gives them the brush of and makes another grab. But more crumbs join the fricus. Again and again, Fingers gets nothing but crumbs. Finally, it's over. Pecan Sandy sidles over and helps me up. I figured Fingers was only after cookies, she said. All he got was crumbs. I kissed her. You're a smart cookie, I say. Maybe being a tough cookie isn't enough. She kisses me. You don't learn quick, she says, but you learn. The end. Or is it?
Okay, boys and girls, so that was Tough Cookie. I hope you enjoyed the story. And now it's time to go. But once again, remember, there's a link below to an art project. I hope you check it out and have some fun. But like always, this is where we part ways, because now I'm able to finally enjoy my milk and cookies. All right, boys and girls, see you later.